Hello, church. Welcome and to worship with Shawnee Community Christian Church. We are delighted that you have chosen to spend your worship time with us. We are a congregation where we strive to be a people of grace and welcome, a community where all, and we really do mean all, are beloved children of God. My name is Rene Jensen. My husband Rick and I are the co-interim pastors of Shawnee Community Church. We hope and pray that you will find this time of worship a blessing. Feel free to contact Rick or me if you have any questions or pastoral concerns. Our contact information is on the website. Now, if we were worshiping in person, we would greet one another with great joy. We would shake hands or give each other a big old church hug. But even worshiping virtually, we can still greet one another. So if you have your cell phone nearby, and these days, who doesn't? Send a text, a word of greeting or hope or peace to someone, or you can just click on the like button at the bottom of the video. Now let us prepare for worship. If you have not yet done so, pause the video to gather up communion supplies, whatever you have nearby, any kind of bread, any kind of liquid can be made holy by God. And now that you have that, let's just take a moment to prepare our spirits and our hearts for worship. Close your eyes. Put both feet flat on the floor. And just take a deep breath. And breathe out. And again. And out. Breathe in the peace and presence of the Holy Spirit. And as you exhale, breathe out anxiety and fear. Now we continue our worship as we hear these words from our elder, Dallas Ford.
Will you join me in prayer? We come to worship a living God, a God of past and future, and of this present precious moment. Let us open our hearts to God's loving presence. May our strength be renewed to sing a new song of God's glory in a world which longs for your justice and peace. And may we all become God's new creation. Amen.
We give God the glory, all the honor. We know that He's Father, Spirit, Jesus. Lord, the worship we bring is more than songs that we sing. It's a reflection of our ever-changing lives, the best we have to offer. We don't just lift up our hands, Lord, we lift up our lives, for we know that You are worthy of our praise. To You our life songs raise. Rescue from darkness, we are walking in the marvelous light, for we are children of the King. Sing, You we bring is more than songs that we sing. It's a reflection of our ever-changing lives, the best we have to offer.
We don't just lift up our hands, Lord, we lift up our lives, for we know that You are worthy of our praise. You are life song praise. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Rick Jensen, co-interim minister with my wife, Rene, at Shawnee Community Christian Church. We are glad to have you with us this morning. Today's topic is titled Easter When Autumn Leaves Fall. And of course, we've seen a lot of leaves change colors over the past couple of weeks, and a lot of leaves fall, especially if we had to rake them up. Well, today we will be looking at, for our scripture, the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 1 through 6. Now, a mistake people commonly make when they refer to this book is they will give it the plural. They'll talk about revelations, but it's only one revelation. And it was a revelation given to the author John of Patmos, who wrote this book, and really had to do as much with a new earth as a new heaven, as we will hear in today's passage. And it's about how the church and the people of God relate to the Roman Empire. And so when this book refers to the beast, it's really talking about Rome. So it actually has some political interest. But today we're talking about resurrection and new life, as John of Patmos describes in this text for today. But then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And to the thirsty, I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. O gracious Lord, we seek your presence this day and every day. And we seek to be able to acknowledge that life and death are simply a part of life, but that even in the worst of times, we can experience your love, your kindness, your justice, and even your joy. So come speak to us, through us, and with us, to your everlasting honor and glory. Amen. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. So Dickens begins A Tale of Two Cities regarding late 18th century London and Paris. They're also true of the months of autumn. This time of year is really the best of times. In many respects, my favorite season. Christmas, crisp morning air that awakens our senses, memories of trick-or-treating at Halloween, and that first sip of delicious hot chocolate. The crystal clear palette of autumn's azure blue skies. These are the halcyon days before the fevered pace of Black Friday and the Christmas season is upon us. Autumn is the best of times. But autumn is also the worst of times. Autumn leaves falling, shedding their branches. Northwest winds hinting that winter's just around the corner. Autumn exposes the worst of times. The worst day in our family's life happened this time of year, November 4th, 1983, to be exact. That evening, Rene was across town in Indianapolis attending a seminar at the seminary. Phone rang. Rene's youngest sister, June, was on the other end of the line. Bad news. Terrible news. Car crash. Their 29-year-old middle sister, Pam, who was 8 months pregnant, along with her daughters, our two nieces, 8-year-old Annie and 5-year-old Amanda, our daughter Erica's age at the time, had all been killed by a drunk driver. Immediately, I started making arrangements to depart for Texas, even before Rene was home. Found a supply preacher, called the church secretary, a few friends, tried to get everything under control, when of course, absolutely nothing was. Finally, Rene returned. If someone else could have done the dirty deed, I would have gladly passed it on. But you'd better sit down. I've got bad news. Gasps, tears, disbelief. Autumn is the worst of times. Oh, autumn comes to everyone, eventually, inescapably. Autumn leaves fall. Darkness comes. Death intrudes upon once carefree lives. Robert Frost captured this vulnerability and inevitability. Eden's first green is gold. Her heart is hue to hold. Her early leaf's a flower, but only so an hour. Then leaf subsides to leaf. So Eden sank to grief. So dawn goes down today. Nothing gold can stay. Dawn gives way to day. Autumn gives way to winter. Life gives way to death. Nothing gold can stay. We wonder, is this the end of the story? Is our destiny resignation? Is our duty resignation? When we're faced with a tragedy, the proportions of my wife's sister and niece's death, we're forced to ask questions of God in our faith that we can otherwise avoid or evade or dismiss. Oh, I've seen terrible tragedies before. My college roommate's death from cancer at age 21. We were in our junior year in college at the time. A house we were living in burning down in the middle of the night, and us and the family we were taking care of barely escaping. Both of our mothers and fathers dying suddenly without giving us a chance to say a final goodbye. We can understand the terrible grief that comes to those who have suddenly lost loved ones to COVID when we aren't even allowed into the hospital room to bid them our final farewell. A long time ago, Old Testament patriarch Jacob's name was changed to Israel, which means struggles with God. Seems Jacob and an angel of the Lord had a set to. Sometimes I think that's all the Christian life is, one struggle after another. And that if a person or a church isn't struggling in some way, they're missing the point. Of making sense of it? 5 years before the accident, as we came to call it, I'd finished my Doctor of Ministry in Philosophical Theology, which is just a fancy way of talking about contemplating the nature and meaning of the universe and life. During one of my classes, my theology professor told us students how he and his wife had lost their 10-year-old son to terminal illness. Learning this, I realized if he had any wisdom on the subject of life and death, I wanted to hear it. Two things, he said, have stuck with me, lo, these many years, as he reflected on his own personal grief, his own personal Israel, his own personal autumn. You never get over the death of one you love, but you do get through it. No denying autumn. And then he quoted Harvard philosopher Alfred North Whitehead, "Nothing beautiful is lost to God." Oh, what great words. Nothing beautiful is lost to God. This made me think in turn of two of Jesus' teachings in Matthew. Let the children come to me and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of God. Surely, I thought, if this is true, and it surely must be, it also means that Annie and Amanda are in God's arms. And then I thought of where Jesus says, "It is my Father's will that my little ones should not suffer." I already knew the scripture well enough to know that the little ones Jesus was referring to meant adult believers, not just children. For my money, it means God embraces all of us, no matter our age. We are all God's little ones. So Renee's sister Pam, who is finally breaking out of her hyperactive teenage years, is also with God. She was becoming, and really always was, a beautiful person, but even more so as she was coming upon her 30s. In the meantime, as Renee says, God gives us Christian faith and Christian friends to see us through. And we are so grateful for those Christian friends and our Christian faith that saw us through probably the worst time in our lives, certainly in our family's life. While at the funeral home, looking over the three caskets lined up end to end, a young woman, meaning well, but tripping badly in her timing, came up to Renee and me and asked whether Pam and the girls were right with God. I had to pause for a moment to realize what she was asking. Like many fund angelists, the young woman assumed God is always on the prowl for backsliders. You know, the road is narrow and those who enter are few. But I don't interpret the scriptures the way a lot of people do. I don't think God is out to see us burn in hell, making heaven an exclusive club. I believe in God's merciful, unconditional, and unmerited love, even for those nobody else likes. God saves whatever is beautiful in us, though I also believe that anything not beautiful in us that is ugly, God discards, having no need of it to reoffer to the world. It's God separating the wheat from the chaff in all of us. And so our time on earth is a time to prune the evil within us in order to let the good in us thrive, to let the very image of God in us show our true colors. All the same, as I thought of the young woman's question, my heart rests in peace because I am thoroughly persuaded that, as the apostle says, that whatever is beautiful, whatever is noble, whatever is true, whatever is excellent, whatever is pure, is never lost to God and will never be lost to God. And this isn't just true of life after death, the new heaven that John of Revelation or Apocalypse talks about. It's also true in the life we lead right now when John speaks of a new earth. Because you see, we share in God's beauty right here. God always meets ugliness with beauty. God always meets evil with goodness, and not just in babies being born, not just in leaves that radiate glorious color, not just in snow-topped purple mountain majesty, or in rainbow-hued Grand Canyons. God always returns our losses with gains, and God always offers glory in the face of tragedy through joyful memories, in showing us life isn't an endless series of dead ends, in giving us hope amid despair, in showing the world an empty tomb beyond a cross. You see, Easter comes even when autumn leaves fall. It's why John of the Apocalypse can write in exile, "I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband." The ultimate victory, eternal Easter, belongs to God, but not just for this life only, but also for the life to come, and not just for the life to come, but also for life now. God is busy, always seeking to birth a new heaven and a new earth. Easter happens even when autumn leaves fall. But ours is not just to watch autumn leaves fall. Ours is to plant tulip bulbs in late autumn as a sign that God's hope and beauty are with us always. Ours is to believe Easter comes even in autumn, because for Christians, Easter never was meant to be just one day in the springtime of the year, or only on one day of the week, because after all, Sundays were meant to be little resurrection days throughout the years. No, Easter is meant to be every single day that we are alive, and even when we aren't. It's like an old Dutch fable told to children. There were three tulip bulbs named Noah, maybe, and yes. They lived at the bottom of a bowl tin, content to be round and fat and clothed in their silky brown garments. When autumn came, they fell to discussing the destiny of tulip bulbs. No, said, I don't think there is any other life for tulip bulbs. Besides, I am satisfied with things as they are. So he rolled over in the corner to sleep the winter away. Maybe, said, I'm not satisfied with the way things are. I feel that there's a better life than the life I now have. I've felt something within me that I must achieve, and I believe that I can achieve it. So he squeezed himself and squeezed himself and squeezed himself and ended up in a fit of frustration. And then Yes said, I have been told that we can do nothing of ourselves, but that the good Lord will fulfill our destiny if we put ourselves in his power. So one day a hand reached down into the bin groping for tulip bulbs. Yes gave himself to the hand and was buried in the earth throughout the long winter months. Meanwhile, No and Maybe shriveled away to nothing. But when spring came, Yes burst forth with all the richness and loveliness of new life. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Easter comes to those who believe God can find us, even in our deepest, darkest days and nights, when autumn leaves fall and tulip bulbs are buried. Easter comes to those who believe that even death itself cannot prevent God from doing a new thing. May it be so, Lord. Amen.
So have you ever wondered why Christians worship on Sunday? I mean, the earliest Christians worshiped on Saturday because they were all Jewish. Jesus was a Jew. All the original disciples were Jew. All the earliest followers of Jesus were all Jewish. And they didn't stop being Jewish when they became followers of Jesus. They went to synagogue. They were obedient to the Jewish law. They were Jewish. They simply added the worship of Christ onto their observances as Jew. And particularly central to that worship was the celebration of this, the Lord's Supper. But at some point, Christianity became increasingly Gentile. And as it became increasingly Gentile, then more and more Gentiles were not required to be obedient to Jewish law or to Jewish worship. And at some point, the Christian day of worship became Sunday, because Sunday was a reminder that Jesus, that this meal is a celebration of Jesus' resurrection, that Sunday, the day of Christian worship, is the day of resurrection. It is a mini Easter, and that was early Christian worship. That was what it was. So this meal is a reminder that when we come together, that we worship a God of life, a God of resurrection, a God of possibility and hope, a God who will, as it says in that passage from Revelation that Rick read earlier, wipe away every tear from our eye and take us to a place beyond mourning and death and loss. One of my pet peeves over the years about this meal, particularly for many disciple churches, has been that is a meal of, it's like a funeral dinner. Everybody's sad and gloomy and very somber, but this is a heavenly banquet. This is a foretelling of that meal we will share with Jesus and all of our loved ones in the kingdom of God. So we come to this heavenly banquet where we take bread as Jesus did on that night before his death. And 3 days before his resurrection, we take bread and we remember that Jesus told us, "This is my body that is broken for you. Take, eat, and remember me." This is the cup of life that I pour out for you. Take, drink, and remember the life that I have come to make possible for you and all who follow me. Drink this in remembrance of me. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, for this bread that we break to remember your great love for us and the possibility of abundant life that you have come to make possible. We drink this cup, which starts as a cup of sorrow but ends as a cup of celebration, just as you moved from suffering and death to life and resurrection. So you move us into the possibility of new life, now and always. Amen.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my to be else to me, savest thou my best thought by day and night, waking or sleeping, my presence, my life. Be thou my wisdom, thou my true word. God be Riches I heed not, for man's empty praise. Thou my inheritance now and always. Thou and thou only, but first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasures thou art.
These days, as we are moving closer and closer to the resurrection, we're all pretty anxious, whether you're going to vote blue or red, or whether you've already voted. There's a lot of anxiety about the outcome of the election. So the Johnson County Disciple Congregations have come together collectively to bathe this anxious day in prayer. All day long, from 6 o'clock in the morning when the polls open till 7 o'clock when they close, Disciple congregations will be signing up to pray for the day, election day. Each congregation is handling their own sign up. So you will see a link in the newsletter to sign up for a slot that day to pray. Some suggestions about how to use that time will be sent to you. Also, Disciple clergy have come together and recorded a prayer service that will be a link to that prayer service will be posted in the newsletter or sent to you sometime close to election day. The details are still being worked out, so pay attention to that as well. And I just encourage all of us to bathe this day and whoever our new elected leaders will be in our prayers for their faithfulness to God's will for our lives and particularly for our nation in their elected duties. Now let us pray in our benediction. Lord Jesus Christ, in this bread and cup, in this bit of bread, this sip of drink, you have put your life in our hands. Now, as we conclude our worship, we put our lives into your hands. Take us, renew us, remake us, shape us into the people that you would have us be. Amen.